master in my car. Falling farther from just what we are. Smoke a cigarette and last some more. These conversations kill. Falling faster.
My name is Tyler from Droids Canada Podcast. Thank you for joining us today. I'm not in the shot, I'm over here. That's okay. Dan's here, of course. He is also my co-host on the show. And ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce one of the most influential comic book creators of all time, Mr. James O'Barr.
How long is this panel?
Up to 45. Oh, you're going
listen
like
now,
so
come on. It's just a speak dual broadcast in French.
Either that or we can spend a little time talking about the Tragic Liad. For Canadian fans out there.
Yeah.
So, James, welcome to Nickel City Con in Buffalo, New York. Now, we'd like to talk to you a little bit about your beginnings and, of course, being the creator of The Crow. Exactly. Now, doing a little bit of research on you, your fan club states that you got your start as an artist doing combat manuals in the Marines. Now, was there anything that you did before that?
Well, I always drew since I was a kid. I mean, I grew up in an orphanage in Detroit, and as it was Detroit, I was the only white kid in there. So no one would play with me. And so I just learned to entertain myself by drawing on any crayons, anything I could find. So I just never quit. I know it's hard to believe, but I was intensely shy in my younger years. Now I just don't give a shit. it was a way for me to express myself.
I can so relate to that, being also a shy kid growing up, having difficulty talking to lots of people, and then at one age it just kind of clicks, and exactly.
I think Noisy was the turning point. If you gotta talk to girls.
So when was it that you realized, you know what, yes, I love this, and this is what I'm going to do, this is what I want to do. Be an artist, be a storyteller.
And I got adopted when I was 7 to a very working class family in Detroit. Just art was not an option. I was wasting my time. My options were, when I graduated, were you college wasn't an option either, so. It's like you either go work on the assembly line at Ford's or you join the military. And our whole neighborhood was full of people that worked on the assembly line, and they were all miserable drunks. So I'm like, that's not for me. So I joined the military 6 years in Berlin, guarding the Berlin Wall. That's how long ago it was. And while I was there, once they found out I could draw, they put me to work illustrating these manuals that hadn't been updated since like World War II. So there was a lot of racist stuff in them, like the Japanese with the Coke bottle glasses and the buck teeth and the stuff you see on the old Warner Brothers cartoons. And so I had to redraw all these manuals with like generic figures, and they had a new manual too, which I used to call Graves Details before, but this new manual was called Proper Care Handling and Disposal of Corpses and Body Parts, and they gave me this huge box full of like blown up bodies and pieces of bodies and. from like all the way back to like World War I, you know. And so I had to redraw all this stuff without the gore. And it, you know, I mean, after a while, it all just looks like meat anyhow. So you know, but a lot of those images stayed with me. You know, like you know, there's I saw photo, you know, like close-up photographs of a kid that couldn't have been more than 16, like half of his head missing. And just being an artist and storyteller, it's just like, not only was the image shocking, but it's like, I want to know this kid's story, you know. You know, did he know what was happening, you know? Was he a virgin, you know? Had he ever even kissed a girl, you know? So yeah, a lot of that stuff stayed with me, and I think a lot of that is evident in my work.
Now, being someone who, you know, spent that much time with the Berlin Wall, what was your feelings when the wall was taken down?
I don't know. It was miserable back then. Because it was only like 40-something years after World War II. And Berlin and Germany, but Berlin in particular was just a fucking miserable city. It's like half the population was ashamed, and the other half was angry still that they had lost. And so it just wasn't a fun time there. And there was lots of terrorist bombings and off-limit zones. And I don't know if you guys have seen Atomic Blonde.
Yes.
But
great film.
It was just like that. Wow, it was just like, it was like the Wild West. It wasn't a good time, you know. I was happy to stay indoors and draw.
So now that you're finished doing your service with the Marines, and now is this when you start illustrating The Crow?
No, actually I started it over there.
Over there?
When I was there. I was dealing, you know, and actually, you know, my fiance was killed by a drunk driver, and so I needed to get out of Detroit, and that was one of the main reasons I joined the military, which is just get away from there. But location doesn't really change anything, and especially when you go to such a bleak place as Berlin in the 70s and 80s, so. So I just, you know, I hadn't dealt with anything, and it was, and I was being very self-destructive. So I just decided to try and, you know, just try and work some of those issues out on paper. Mm-hmm. So it was more like a diary, you know.
Mm-hmm. Now that spent after completion 8 years.
It took 8 years
on the shelf before published.
Well, no, it took 8 years to finish it because. It was just hard to work on, because I would do three, you know, it was like picking at a scab, or, you know, putting your finger in a wound, you know. I could do three or four pages, and then I would have to stop, because it was just too painful. So it took a total of about 8 years for me to finish it, and I really didn't even think about publishing it, which is something I did for myself. And I think that shows in the book. It's very intimate and personal. It was just like on a whim that it did end up getting published. After I got released from military service, I went back to Detroit. And I was working on cars during the day. I worked at a Ford dealership for 12 years. And I would draw all night, and there was this one big comic store in Detroit that everybody used to go to, because the owner would order, you know, at least one copy of everything, so you could find like really obscure things and European books and things. But he saw all these talented artists coming in there, Guy Davis and Vince Locke, Mark Bloodworth. They, a lot of really talented artists in the Detroit area. And he saw us all coming in there not really doing anything. And so he decided to start a publishing company out of the back of his comic book store, which turned out to be Caliber Comics. He cleared out the gaming room in the back of his store. And that was Caliber Publishing. Yeah, almost like a real business.
Is Caliber Publishing the one that picked up?
Yeah, yeah. And honestly, the owner, Gary Reed, he didn't, you know, he asked me if I had anything. So I brought the Crow in just to show him. And he didn't like it. He didn't get it. He didn't understand it. I think it's safe to say he hated it, you know, because it wasn't superheroes. And at that time, it was like elves were the end thing, like ElfQuest.
Yeah.
You know, there was just like a million of these elf books out there, and it was like nothing he had seen before. And he's like, it's dark, it's depressing, it's, you know, it's non-linear. It starts in the middle and works its way backwards. He didn't like it at all. And he only published it because, at that time, there was a place called Preeny Press and Litho in Windsor, like right across the bridge from Detroit in Canada. And they were publishing Cerebus and a lot of independent stuff. But to get a discount, you have to bulk print books. And he needed a fifth book to get the discount. So he just threw the Crow in there. Just to get the discount, you know, he didn't think it would sell anything, and I think it was the only book at Caliber that made money.
So now you have.
But still, to the day he died, which was a couple of years ago, he still did not get it. He did not understand it.
Maybe if you had a little pointy ears on the,
you know, fairies and wizards and. So
now the book is out, and now the book has sold, and the story of the Crow is out there. The story of you, you know, sorry to say, with the tragedy and the loss, and that has kind of created this, you know, this aura around this book. Now, for me, getting into the Crow as well, it had something to do with the tragedy as well. The tragedy involved with you, the tragedy with the movie being created. You know, other people have had their tragedy as well. Now, seeing somebody go through this, go through their pain and continue and finish this on, that has helped a lot of people through as well, saying, oh my gosh, this man has done this. I can do this as well. Now, how is it a feeling to you that I've been able to help people through with my artwork?
Well, I mean, it's immensely flattering. I mean, that was never my intention. I was just trying to work through my own problems, you know. And I think people ask me, oh, you know, it's if you're depressed or suicidal, it's like, go talk to James, you know. And it's just, thanks. I feel like the world's misery dumpster, but yeah. But the, you know, I mean, there was a long time where I didn't care if I died, but I you know, I wasn't gonna kill myself, you know. So it was just like, I know there's something better out there, and you just gotta stay strong and keep pushing, and, you know. I mean, I had bouts of severe depression that lasted years, you know, but I got up every day, I went to work. Just the idea of surrendering, you know, didn't occur to me. It occurred to me. I mean, I thought about it many times, but I'm like, wow, who the fuck's gonna clean up the mess afterwards? You know, it's, you know.
So, being credited with everything to do with Crow, there's been many different stories, many different incarnations of the Crow. Now, which one did you? Is there any specific version that you found more difficult to write?
Yeah, and actually it was one I did a couple of years ago with IDW. And so, you know, and there's been many, you know, many different incarnations, you know. My one rule is that with anybody I work with is that you can't use Eric and Shelley. That story's told. That story has an ending. But I mean, those are all universal themes, and you can use them in any circumstance, any time period. You know, I wrote one a couple of years ago that takes place in a World War II concentration camp about a Polish gentleman that goes up in the ovens, and he is not happy about it. But the one I did after that, and it was based on a true story too, about something that happened in Detroit in the 60s. I thought that was cops.
I thought the exact same
call
thing.
Call me Bill.
Quickly looking at the exit strategy.
Yeah, there was in the 60s, and I read it in the papers, because it was like one of those human interest stories, or like unsolved mystery things, about this little six-year-old girl that was raped and murdered and left in a park. No one ever claimed the body. They never knew her name. And in fact, on her tombstone, it says Little Miss 1565, which was her case number. Mm-hmm. But this one policeman in Detroit, he literally like destroyed his life trying to solve this thing. You know, he lost his family just because he was obsessed by it. He lost his family, eventually his job. And, you know, and unfortunately, he never did solve it. To have the little girl come back and help him solve it, you know. So it's more about absolution for the policeman than it is for the little girl, who's perfectly happy being dead, you know. But she wants to help this policeman. Mm-hmm. So, but I mean, just the subject matter of, an unsolved child murder doesn't have a lot of giggles in it, you know. So it was really difficult to write. But, you know, I think it's probably one of the best written things I've ever done. And it won all kinds of awards. You know, it's called Curare, which is like one of the world's most deadly poisons. The girl's name is Carrie. Can't quite pronounce it right. So I, you know, it was a big relief when I finished the book. You know, but you know, and I'm working on some things now that are really personal and intimate and difficult. You know, but it's like if you just have to be fearless, you know. Because I realized a long time ago, especially, you know, when The Crow came out and it got mass acceptance, you know, got essentially assimilated into the mainstream. It's like, well, I'm no different, you know, I thought I was weird, but I'm no different than anybody else, you know. It's just like, we all feel these same things, you know. We just don't, we don't show them, or we don't express them, or address them, you know, about, you know, depression or sadness or loss. Or anger, so that just makes it a lot easier. You just have to be fearless, you know. Don't be afraid to make an asshole of yourself.
I make your career on it. I truly do.
Well, that was aimed towards you. That was a bit of
it's like we know each other now.
It's a life hack. Don't be afraid.
So, with the initial, your first illustration of The Crow. Now, is that something, you know, I know online I've heard of the story of the $20 wedding ring,
yeah.
The things that have happened. Now,
yeah, that was true, too. It was a couple in Detroit was murdered over, actually it was a $30 engagement ring, you know, and it's just like, what a horrible loss
way, yes.
For nothing, you know. So, you know, it's just, I like to put a lot of, to me, if you base it around something truthful, then then it has a really solid base, you know. And that gives me room to dance around it, you know. If I have something factual at the heart of it.
Now, is the first creation of The Crow about yourself, or is it a character created?
Well, the hand is no different than what it creates, you know. So the book was kind of, you know, it was like a diary. I'm very much like Eric. So, I didn't want to do a physical representation. My fiance was killed by a drunk driver. He got 6 months in jail, and my life was irrevocably changed forever, you know. So I had a lot of anger towards everything, you know. No justice in real life, compounded with the loss, you know. I think I answered that right.
So then with the character, the iconic vision of the character, the face paint.
Yeah.
How did you come about doing the face paint, and how does it change for each different character?
When I was in the military, I took I traveled all over Europe when I was in the military on my time off. And I went to England, I went to London, and they had like the Royal Shakespeare Company. I had a building there, and on the side of it were, in America we have comedy and tragedy, you know, those two faces.
Yeah, the two. Mm-hmm.
And they had comedy, tragedy, and irony, and it was just a really striking drawing on the side of a building. When I was designing The Crow, I thought it would be really ironic to have the saddest man in the world with a forced smile painted on his face. So it had nothing to do with Kiss.
I heard Kiss and Alice Cooper.
Alice Cooper, yeah.
I'd never thought of that. And The Crow had nothing to do with Edgar Allan Poe or The Raven. I didn't think of that till afterwards either. You know, like, shit. And I picked a crow because it's a carrion bird that lives off dead things, and essentially that's what Eric is. He's only there to make dead things. You know, that's what keeps him in that specific point in time.
Mm. So now, years have passed, 1993, 1994. This is a feature film now.
Yeah.
So, film is made. Now, What involvement did you have with the film? Was it just based on your story, or were you right in there?
No, I was there involved from beginning to end.
Did you assist in the casting of it?
Oh yeah,
that was casting.
Yeah, it was like, I would say 90% of the cast were my suggestions. You know, I never thought in a million years any of those people would do it, because it was a $10 million movie. Based on some, you know, obscure cult comic book, but I think virtually everyone they approached said yes for some reason, except for Iggy Pop. Iggy Pop was supposed to play Fun Boy, and he wanted to do it, but he was late with the record, and his record company threatened to sue him if he took time off to do the movie. Yeah, I'm just like, you know, I had just saw this Ridley Scott movie, 1492, about Columbus, and Michael Wincott was in that, and he was just, you know, I mean, he was, typically Michael Wincott, he's an asshole, but he's so charismatic, you can't take your eyes off of him, you know?
Right.
But I thought, he just did a Ridley Scott film, there's no way he's going to do this little independent, low-budget movie. For some reason, he agreed, you know.
Also, the confidence and vulnerability of Rochelle Davis.
Yeah.
In that as well. She was so phenomenal.
Yeah, her first and only movie, unfortunately. And But she worked hard. She you know, she couldn't skateboard worth a shit. So she was just constantly falling down. It's like, oh, that poor girl, you know. She's falling down. It's freezing. I didn't get to know Rochelle till like after the shoot, because for some reason the director, you know, I was there basically to help the actors, you know, like tell them the backstory of the characters or just help them with dialogue, whatever they needed. And he told me to stay away from Rochelle for some reason. Actually, not being involved with the film. Brandon's death that brought back a lot of guilt. So I had a few years. Well, I made it worse for myself too, because I got to be really good friends with Brandon. He was like a little brother to me. They had no term for it back then, but it's just like that survivor guilt is just, I mean, it was monstrous. I didn't know what to do, and then it's like I felt like I had gotten Brandon success, you know. I'm like, this is his movie, why, you know. And then they needed somebody, Miramax needed somebody to promote the film and do all the press, and because they had Hamlet without Hamlet, you know. So I agreed to go wherever it opened in the world. I went to do all the press that Brandon should have done. And that was, you know, it was just torturous, you know. I had fun with some of the reporters in other countries, you know, because he had been there a couple of years before promoting Rapid Fire. So we got to exchange stories and things like that. But it was really a hard, tough time, you know. And yeah, it was just like every day dealing with my friend's death, and the fact that I'm being successful, you know, not because of his death, but I just felt like this belongs to him, and I'm reaping the reward. So, after that, I had a couple. I just disappeared, you know. Like I needed a break from all of it. It had taken over my life, and I self-medicated for a while because it was just painful, you know.
Mm-hmm. Now then, with the movie, one of my favorite things about the movie is the soundtrack. I do believe it is one of the greatest soundtracks to any movie in history.
Oh, well, thanks.
Did you have say with some of the music that was done in that?
Almost all of it, yeah. When I was in Detroit, besides working on cars and doing comics, because I'm always heavily influenced by music, I used to write reviews for Spin Magazine, basically just to get free records. They would just send me a box of free records, you know, every week. And it didn't pay shit. It was like $30 for a review, but I got to, you know, discover a lot of really cool bands. And one of the perks of that is whenever that band played Detroit, I got to go meet them and interview them and hang out with them, you know. And I always gave them copies of The Crow to lead. Because I was in bands before, and I know how boring it is to drive through fucking Wisconsin in the middle of the winter and play for 12 people, you know.
Been there, done that myself. Yeah. Yeah. So, not in Wisconsin, above the canyon. No, I commented on the Joy Division patch that you have on, because on that, the Trent Reznor version of Dead Souls,
yeah.
Oh my God, this song's so awesome. It's Joy Division.
He did not want to do that either. I had a twisted arm.
So you got him to do that cover.
Yeah. He was like, the Beatles and Joy Division are sacred ground. You just don't fuck with them. You're just going to make an idiot of yourself. We couldn't get the rights to use the original. Because Factory Records had went bankrupt and no one knew who owned the rights at that point. Yeah, he agreed to do it, but like straight up, he didn't turn it into a Nine Inch Nails song. Mm-hmm. And I know he was happy he did, because he told me he made more money off that one song than he did off all of Pretty Hate Machine.
No, I will say, well, that soundtrack's probably one of the top selling soundtracks of all time. Like The Cure on that, and
That soundtrack's been in my car now for 10 years. Yeah. It's not left. Well, I have this. Was it your decision to put My Life with a Thrill Kill Cult on there?
Yeah,
I love that track. Thank you for putting that track on there.
Being that I was from Detroit, I mean, there was a good music scene in Detroit, but at that time in the 80s, in the early 90s, it was like Chicago was where like everything was happening. Right. So I would take the train up there every weekend and go see all these great bands, Nine Inch Nails and Thrill Kill Cult. Everything was kind of centered around Chicago at that time. Right. Big Black, all the touch and go bands. But when we started making the film and it looked like it was going to be something good, I contacted everyone whose music I liked and said, "You guys want to do something for this? It looks like it's going to be really good." And you have to remember that at that point in time, almost no one knew who these bands were. They weren't big yet.
Right.
I think everyone I asked agreed, and we ended up with like 28 songs. And the ones that weren't used were given back to the bands. Some of them, there just wasn't space for them. And other ones were just, like Sisters of Mercy did. It was called Under the Gun, and after what had happened to Brandon, it was just inappropriate. So, Psychedelic Furs did a really good one, but there was just no place in there for it.
We're actually listening to some Psychedelic Furs on the way to the con today. Heard it on the radio.
Yes. So we're coming near the end here. Does anyone from the crowd want to maybe toss a we're done there.
I heard that excitement.
Well, I want to make sure everyone has a chance. So go ahead.
First of all, thank you for your service.
Sure.
This is on.
I didn't kill anybody.
I don't care. This is my military.
Yeah.
I honor my veterans. This is on my bucket list. I saw The Crow at Eastern Hills Mall at midnight, and I was just blown away. And I've seen the other interviews that you have actually friends with Brandon Link.
Yeah.
You also had a cameo in the movie. Were you the one after Gideon's pawn shop blew up and you were trying to loot it? I told you
that. What do you mean trying?
Well, I had to pause.
Actually, that was, I was there the whole time.
Right.
So, if you've ever been on a movie set, it's like 10 minutes of furious work and then 4 hours of standing around. Waiting for them to reset cameras or, move to a new one. It's just like, it's very tedious, And, the director came up and said, "Do you want to be a looter in this next scene?" And I said, "No." And he said, "It pays $300. And I said, "Yes." he played a trick on me, too, because there were like, it was probably about 8 people that were looters, and he only put the camera on me.
Right, because I had to pause it, and I saw you had longer hair at that time, I believe.
Yeah, he only put the camera on me, and but I fucking earned that. he's one of those, "Very good, let's do it again." So I had to do that like 5 or 6 times, it was literally right after the pawn shop exploded, and that TV was hot. It was like melted plastic, I definitely earned that $300.
Thank you. Go ahead.
You started the project for therapy, and you said you don't necessarily want it published, but with the success of it, did it draw out the healing process for you at all? You were kind of forced to relive it?
It wasn't. It got rid of the self-destructive impulses, but it didn't really have a was still deeply depressed afterwards, you know. Just because I hadn't really dealt with the issues, you know. I didn't go through those those steps of grieving, you know. I got stuck in anger. It didn't have the desired effect, you know. But I'm happy and well adjusted now.
Go ahead.
I had read that you were working on, I don't know if it's been published yet, a comic about the Chosen Reservoir.
Yeah, yeah.
And so what ever became of that, or?
I need to stay home long enough to. my publisher's getting impatient. Well, when I started this, doing these conventions, and like 1990, and then the movie came out, and you know, it's just like, oh, I'm the guest of honor at San Diego. How cool! It wasn't cool because that doesn't mean shit. You still have to pay for your table and your flight and your hotel. I mean, you just get a little plaque, but you know. But I digress. but I thought, oh, okay, this will last about 18 months, and then people will move on to something else, and I'll just enjoy my decline, you know. So I was just like, so I never said no to anything. It's like, do you want to come to it? And I'm like, yes, you know. And it's, you know, it's like 30 years later, I'm still kind of in that mindset, you know. You know, do you want to come to Possum Hollow, Alabama? Not really, but sure. Yeah. Do they got teeth there? I don't know.
I met you 3 years ago at Twin Tears Comic Con, Elmira. And you had mentioned that there was some work, something being done about like another movie based on The Crow, but more true to the comic.
Yeah.
Has anything come from that yet?
Yeah, we're doing another Crow film that is it's much closer to the comic. And if you read the book, you know the movie's like maybe 30% of the book.
Right.
And it's not that they didn't want to do a really faithful adaptation. It's just like that's a $10 million movie, and they had three weeks to make it in. So it's just like it wasn't in the budget to do. So this is a chance to do like a really faithful adaptation, you know. It's going to be completely different than the Brandon Wakefield, you know. I think closer to Taxi Driver than to that kind of John Woo stylized violence. And Jason Momoa is going to be great.
As I've heard.
He's losing 50 pounds for it.
Wow.
I was with him last weekend, and he said it's been his dream role since he was like 16 years old. So I'm pretty enthusiastic about it.
Any more questions? All right, go ahead. Don't mind.
What was it like to work with the cast? Ernie Hudson, Michael Wink, David Petrie.
You know what I found, and I've worked on a lot of movies besides The Crow. You know what I found is like, the bad guys in movies are the nicest people you will ever meet. I mean, literally, they're just like sweethearts, you know. And the heroes are total assholes, you know. The only one on the set that no one got along with, it wasn't just me, was Michael Wincott.
Really?
He just, and I was talking to Ernie Hudson about it not that long ago, and he said, you know what? He's like, I think he's one of those, because he's a phenomenal actor,
yeah,
you know. I think he's one of those actors that stays in character in between scenes, you know. Because I went up to talk to him, because when he was given that big speech at the table, I went up to suggest some more dialogue.
I was getting fired or what?
Yeah, and I went up to talk to him, and he like flicked a lit cigarette at me. And I'm like, wow, what a dick.
Perfect for the role.
Yeah, he was, you know, and he's a phenomenal actor. He's good in everything I've seen him in, you know. but he's difficult.
What about, like, there's not supposed to be real bullets on a set that was taken. Do you think that was such a freak accident? Or
it was a series of fuck-ups that did not have to occur.
I mean, you also had the Bruce Lee curse, you know. His spotter bag supposedly from Painkiller.
Yeah.
The only one that's still around is Shannon now so far,
yeah.
So.
Yeah.
That broke my heart when I I was working at a video store when I found that out, and I was a big fan of his father's, his son,
yeah.
And his daughter. And
yeah. No, but I mean, there's no curse. There's
I mean,
nothing.
He could have been phenomenal, even
yeah.
More
yeah.
Than his father if he would have survived.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I think what we think of as like, you know, and. A leading actor in an action film, I think it would be totally different now. Brandon, I don't think Vin Diesel would be the shit that he is now if
right.
Brandon was still around. I know for a fact Brandon could have kicked his ass.
Oh,
I'm surprised Vin Diesel hasn't been around doing the convention because I guess he's a very big Dungeons and Dragons fan.
Yeah,
he is.
Him and
Joe Magliano, crazy into D&D.
Yeah. Guilty. I want to see a fist fight between
old?
Him and The Rock, though.
Oh, yeah.
I'm dying to see that. I would pay money to see that.
No, do you think that is real beef, or
that is real beef?
To
that
go
is
out
completely
just to
real.
Keep talk.
No, I think they definitely don't like each other.
When you know, the thing is about The Rock, he says nothing negative about anyone.
No, he's a nice guy.
But when he says something negative, it's got to be bad.
Yeah.
Any more questions, guys? Yes.
Did all kinds of research on that, and you know, he ended up with a bad drinking problem, and you know, he would like take his family on vacations to track down leads, you know, and so eventually his wife and two daughters left him, and he was forced to retire just because he was obsessed by it. But no, he never did so. In the comic book, I based the character on Dennis Franz from NYPD. So, because he's like my perfect, he's an asshole, but you love him.
Yeah. Okay, we have time for one more question. Go ahead.
I think I heard you donated a lot of the money from the film to charities because of what happened.
Yeah. I mean, I've never talked about that before because to me it's not charity if you get credit for it. You know, it's to me it's like, and I don't want to sound pessimistic or I don't want to, but I mean, would Johnny Depp have visited those kids in the hospital if there wasn't a fucking camera in the room? You know, so it's just like, yeah, all the money I made from the movie. Donated to children's charities, so I made enough off the book to where I didn't need that and I didn't want it, and I wanted something good to come out of it. And growing up in an orphanage, it's like everything I owned was donated. All my clothes, my shoes, you know, everything I had was given. So I it's just like I still, when I'm doing conventions, I just. I usually, if they're going to have an art show, I usually insist that the proceeds go to something for children.
All right, guys, you guys have been a great crowd. Let's give a round to James McFarland.
Good.
Please come see him on the floor. Enjoy the rest of your day, guys.